My name is Marin Ireland, and I played Alma Wine Miller in Summer and Smoke. I tried my best to get out of playing Alma. The only times I did plays in New York that weren't brand new, they were not received well. My work in particular. I believe the term miscast was used. I had done the Transport Group Classic Stage Company reading of Summer and Smoke a year earlier, and it felt like the biggest gift just to have a low-stakes, high-gain experience inside of a brilliant play. They asked me to do the full production, and I thought they were nuts. I believed I was no one's idea of Alma. She is historically imagined, at least this is what I thought to be true, as a delicate flower, a prudish, anemic ice queen reptile with asthma. I tend to be thought of as someone who plays women who do lots of yelling and who are feral and unwashed and throw chairs at ex-boyfriends or otherwise attack people. I was the wrong person. Or at least, everyone who came to see it would think so. But I said yes because I know a blue moon when I see one. After the reading, I don't know. I kind of felt like it would be amazing to do, but the play was so enormous that I felt like, how are they gonna do that? You know, people can't do plays this big anymore in this economy, you know? I always just end up trying to feel like, just have that moment, be grateful for that moment. Maybe that was all it was ever gonna be, and you got to do it for that day, and great. When I got the email, I think it was Jack saying, we wanna do it in this slot, it felt like the world spun upside down. Like, I was like, what? You know, like, it seemed completely improbable. The kind of actor that I am and what I'm interested in doing and the kind of art I'm interested in making, I don't even know if I would say yes to a production of Summer and Smoke, even though it's like a dream role, if it was going to be a traditional production at, like, we insert name of, you know, commercial theater here. Because that, in my mind, is a blur of parasols and obfuscation. So when Jack told me, and Nathan, I think he told us together, about the design and all of that, the relief that washed over me and the excitement, the like simultaneous like inspiration and excitement about that, was like overwhelming, because I was sort of like, this is why I wanted to do it with Jack and with Transport Group. And why I actually might not have said yes to like a traditional production of it. The thing that makes these plays exciting is what's happening between the people, not all that other stuff to me. And it felt like, oh, this is a reason to do this play also here in New York and now. Then, right before we started, I ended up reprising Martina Myoke's Ironbound in Los Angeles. So I had to start learning Alma in LA. And I am not exaggerating when I tell you all that I could not do it. The words would not go in. I believe I told my agents that I was probably gonna quit. It was maybe 3 weeks out, after like a week of trying to learn lines, and I couldn't do it. What was funny is I talked to a friend of mine, an actress who lives in LA. I went for a walk with her and I was like telling her, and I was like weeping. I was just like, I just don't know, I can't make, you know? And she was like, oh, you're thinking you're gonna quit? She was like, maybe you should just like read it one last time tonight and be sure. I went home and I read it. And by the time I got to scene 11, I was like inconsolably weeping. And I wrote my agents at like midnight and I was like, this play moves me beyond words. I think I can't not do it. So sorry, I'm doing it. They're like, okay, like, you know, they don't care. But I was like literally like a hair's breadth, because I was like, I have to quit. Like, I will destroy this production. I can't show up with not even one sentence learned and no idea how to do this accent. I cannot do that. We started work. I showed up. I told everyone in the room I didn't know what I was doing. I did things anyway. I told Jack Cummings, our director, that I knew Alma was supposed to have all these eccentricities, but I was scared if I started with them, it would be a hollow egg of a performance, and I didn't understand her yet. I hoped that if I started honestly, then all those affectations would just grow out of her, sprout like leaves, like flowers. I don't have as much of an interest in doing a thing I've done before or whatever, so it has to be, if there's two things and one is less scary, and you're like, kind of feel like I know how to do that already, then you gotta do the one that you don't know how to do. It's a drive that I think feels like, it feels like ambition, but it's like a, a personal ambition. It's like a creative, artistic ambition for my own self. But I'm always like, oh my gosh, one day I'll know how to do this. There'll be a day where I'll just be like in the run, and whatever it is, I'll be doing it. And there'll be like a whole new room I discovered somewhere in my soul or something. And I think that excites me. I knew this was a chance that I would never get again. And I knew that the only way not to squander it was to bring everything in me. So that meant all of my shame, all of my fear, all of my loneliness and rage and desperation. This was a chance to take the ride all the way to the end. This was a part that takes you as high and as far as you are willing to go. And I knew that when I failed epically in the eyes of the public, that if I had left it all out on the floor, I would be able to hold my head up and say, at least I gave it everything I had. There's like a thing that Ann Carson wrote once about tragedy, and it's like, who wants to have to go down deep and purge all these things? Like, nobody really wants to go dive down and sit in all of that. So an actor sacrifices hours of their life to do that for you. And I think of it that way very much. I think of it as I'm like giving my time and my soul for other people in that way. I definitely have like an addiction to trying to understand that, like the height and the depth and like, what are our souls capable of experiencing? There's a weird way in which I feel slightly as an actor, like almost more comfortable with parts where you leave it all out there, because I feel like that's what I've like spent my life doing. I do believe in something like destiny when it comes to these things. It didn't work. I was still struggling. I was still fighting until I gave over, let her sing her songs through me, gave in completely. All the reasons I wanted to run from her were also the destination. That production was one of the all-time most meaningful experiences of my life. Having to surrender my ego, having to acknowledge that people might not like what I was gonna be doing, but that I was trying as hard as I could possibly try to honor the text. It felt like a genuinely spiritual experience, and those are so rare. I'm grateful to her, to Tennessee. I miss her. She turned me inside out. She taught me so much about many things, but especially about giving up. Okay, she said. Go ahead, give up, she said, and see what happens next. There's no place that I know of in this city or anywhere on earth like the Transport Group under the direction of Jack Cummings. The theater, the art, the work that they make is the most expansive and thrilling and creative and artistically rejuvenating that I've seen anywhere in the world. And on their 20th anniversary, please, let's all make sure they can keep going for not just another 20 years, but until the end of time.